gentlemen, friends.
Is the singularity near?
The military-industrial complex.
The truth is out there.
The seven mountains of the influencers of culture.
To be as gods, you know,
catapult the propaganda.
From a mostly secure, undisclosed split-level location on a cul-de-sac somewhere in the heartland of America, this is A View from the Bunker. Now, here's Derek Gilbert.
People ask me how I can possibly conduct so many interviews at the prophecy conferences over the last 5 years. I think the various conferences I've done 18, 20. I think we managed to get 25 at the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference this year, 24 maybe. But the fact is I get to talk to people who are experts in their fields, who are doing research on topics that I find fascinating. And so I just get really energized with that opportunity. And the more I learn from these different speakers, the more I can piece together the puzzle or the mosaic of what is going on out there. Welcome to A View from the Bunker. I'm Derek Gilbert. Our series of interviews from the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference continues this week with two men who are very different in their approach to the supernatural realm, but both have valuable information that they bring to the table. One is a very quiet scholar, but as they say, still waters run deep. Another is very effusive, ebullient, as friendly a guy as you want to meet, and but also bringing some evidence to the table that I think is very compelling, that convinces me even more that we are all deployed on a battlefield, whether we recognize it or not. So this week, the interviews from the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference. Doc Marquis, and we begin with Ken Johnson. If somebody asked you to identify the book that contained end times prophecies of tribulation, the tribulation period, the Book of Enoch is probably not one that you would name. I'm Derek Gilbert at the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference with a gentleman who's written a number of books, and many of them deal with the teachings of the early church fathers. In fact, his most recent book, The End Times by the Ancient Church Fathers. It is our pleasure to welcome Ken Johnson to the interview room. Ken?
Thank you for having me.
The Book of Enoch is one that gets people a little excited on, I guess, both sides. There are some who find it to be really helpful in better understanding some of the trickier sections of the Old Testament. For example, we know more about what happened in Genesis 6, the first four verses there, the Nephilim, because of what is elaborated upon in the Book of Enoch. But there are others who see it as, since it's non-canonical, that we should just ignore it altogether because there's a reason that the Holy Spirit did not lead the early church to accept it fully as canon. What do you see in the Book of Enoch, and how does it relate to our understanding of Bible prophecy?
Well, both of those points of view are true. I mean, we definitely have to look at just canonical scripture and base everything by it. However, just like I would take a course on auto mechanics or something, there's nothing about that in scripture. So it doesn't mean it's inspired, but it doesn't necessarily mean that we shouldn't study something else. And any kind of ancient history, The Old Testament is full of references to, if you want to know more about this subject, look at this book, mm-hmm. look at that book, Book of Jasher, Book of Enoch, several things like that. So again, you could say the Holy Spirit didn't include it in the canon, that he didn't want it for a certain reason. Obviously that's true. But he also mentioned it, and he mentioned it for a reason. Obviously that's true. So we need to put all this stuff together. So we know the Holy Spirit is protecting Scripture. These things may or may not have been tampered with over the centuries, but they're things that we should definitely look at.
Hmm. So what are the, and I've not read the Book of Enoch. I've read sections of it, but typically it's, you know, I'm guilty of doing this with other parts of the Bible as well. I'll read the parts that I find interesting and then skip over the other stuff. Yeah. Trying to get better about that, Sharon and I are going through the Bible in chronological order now and doing a verse-by-verse exegesis. But with Enoch, it's been, you know, reading the parts that relate to the giants, the Nephilim.
Yes.
So I must have missed the parts where there are prophecies of tribulation. Where do you find that, and what does the book say?
Actually, there's quite a bit in there, and that's what most of us do. We look at the interesting parts
right.
and forget the rest of it. But in the first six chapters, it's an introduction to those that live in the tribulation period, that time right before the kingdom is basically comes. and it uses other words to describe it, but it's talking about that specifically. And it gives you a reason why this is coming and a reason why we should be godly, and talks about the judgment of the ungodly when God sets up the kingdom. And then there's the section about the Nephilim, and that's what everybody's really interested in.
Sure, yeah.
Because we all know about morality. Mm-hmm. That's the first part. And Nephilim is the second part. And then the rest of it, you just never get around to reading. Mm-hmm. You know, but it's got some fantastic prophecies in it. Some of the prophecies deal with the fact that there would be two destructions, one by flood of water, one by fire. There's a lot of prophecies about the first coming of the Messiah, what he is, how he does the things or would do the things when he comes. Doesn't necessarily say there's two, but it describes things that happened, according to the Bible, in the first coming, and will happen later, haven't happened yet. And then there's some very detailed information. A lot of people know Daniel, the 70 weeks prophecy, where it's 70 weeks of years. Well, there's a section in Enoch, for instance, that gives a 10-week prophecy, where each year is a day, actually, so it's a little different. But he'll say, in this day, certain things happen, this day, certain things happen. And so far, it's been completely accurate. Remember that even if you consider it to be a fake, it's been at least 2,000 years or before since it was put together. It's been in the collection of the Ethiopic church in their canon. But it goes on and talks about these things and gives approximate dates for a great white throne judgment, a tribulation period, a millennial reign, these type of things. And it's really fascinating. It talks about how the Messiah, it mentions a Messiah, it mentions a son of man, it mentions this person, whoever this person is, that somehow comes and fixes the problem man has with God. It's got something to do with him shedding his blood, something about him ruling even though his blood is shed. How does that work? So you can see a resurrection. There's all sorts of things. This one is even born of a virgin and somehow is equal with the Father. And there's a whole bunch of things like that in there. And it's all the way through the passages. So if you're not looking for that kind of thing, you miss it. And that's what I did a lot of times with the church fathers. It gets so dry and so boring. It's sermon after sermon after sermon. And I tried to say, okay, I know how to be good, so put all that stuff away. The moral part. Did he say anything about rapture? Did he say anything about how to get saved? Do the prophecies, you know, still happen, you know? So you have to look through that stuff. And it takes a while to go through all that. But the Book of Enoch is one of the books that is mentioned by Scripture, recommended reading. And so it's something very important. You know, and always remember that over the centuries, anything outside the Bible could have been tampered with.
Right.
Or even mistranslated. So you have to be real, real careful about that.
So how closely does do the prophecies in the Book of Enoch track with those in the Bible? I mean, is it fairly consistent? Does it contradict? I mean, how much of this is helpful and how much of it is just entertaining reading?
Well, nothing in it contradicts. I thought that was pretty interesting. And as far as like whether it, or I should say so far, it has not contradicted. We'll have to see in the next coming years. But for instance, Enoch gives an approximate time period of when the millennial reign would start, you know, down to a day, his concept of 100 years, somewhere between 1975 and 2075. And there are other prophecies and other scrolls and even in the scriptures that kind of point to that kind of a time period. I always had 73 to 70, you know, 2070 something. And so we're sitting here at 2016.
Right.
You know, 40 years into that 100-year time period. And things are getting closer and closer.
Yeah, we're seeing things picking up. I mean, we're moving into the second quarter. If you were, you know, if this were a basketball game or a football game, we're into the, you know, midway through the second quarter here. And as we record this on July 15th of 2016, we saw another horrific Islamic terror attack with a truck in the city of Nice in France. And now we don't even really know what's going on in Turkey. But as we record this right now, Western news agencies are trying to figure out what is happening in the only Islamic state that is a member of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO. It is remarkable. I talked with Bill Salas a couple of weeks ago about Britain's Brexit vote and whether that would have any impact on the
interpretation of Scripture of the Antichrist emerging from a revived Roman Empire, because the European Union was assumed to be that empire. And what we're seeing just over the last couple of days with security issues due to Islamic violent Islam and the unrest in Turkey, which of course borders on Syria, which is a state that's been in turmoil since 2011. The conflict that Turkey's had with Russia in recent months, we're seeing that it's plausible that a geopolitical event we could not have predicted a year ago could compel people to seek more global intervention or control over events to give them a sense of security, again, leading to that revived Roman Empire. So what sort of tribulation does the Book of Enoch foretell? Does it look anything? How does it compare with the period we call the tribulation that we see in the Book of Revelation?
It does talk quite a bit about judgments, and the judgments are fire, lots of different things being destroyed. Not as specific as in the Book of Revelation, where you've got a certain thing happening and one third of the plants, or you know, those type of things. But there are quite a few similarities in that kind of stuff. And then the talking about the recreation and the fact that a perfect society basically is created by God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and the timetable is interesting, that the last 1,000 years of human history is this utopia.
Hmm.
And so it's
the millennial reign.
Yeah, a millennial reign. So just like the ancient church fathers had always taught that the millennial reign would start in the year 6,000, except the calendar's messed up, so we don't know exactly. So they said somewhere in the neighborhood of the year 2000, you know, 2,000 years after Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's interesting that we're in that neck of the woods now.
Yeah.
2,000 years after his birth, of course, would have been 1998, so we passed that.
Mm-hmm.
2,000 years after the event that took place is 32 AD, and we're still getting close to 2032, so another 10 years, more or less.
Hmm.
So we're in that neighborhood now. There are several prophecies that need to take place for Israel to do certain things. Nothing that's a prerequisite for the rapture.
Hmm.
So it's really interesting to look and see and try to figure out, you know, the things that are going on.
What do we know about the translations of the Book of Enoch that are available to us? Can we make any estimate as to when the original texts were written?
There's actually been, it's obvious when you look at it, there's been rewrites. For instance, if it was written by Enoch, as it says that it was, there's no way he would have known about the city of Dan.
Oh, sure.
Dan would have been,
right.
Or Persia, or things like that. And so some people will point to those prophecies that it predicts a war between Iran, Persia, and Israel.
Mm-hmm.
Right toward the end of time. And so that has not yet happened. But how would they know this? Well, the same places had other names previously.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's the same kind of an argument that everybody uses. You can look at something and know it's at least so many years old. You know, because I could use the same argument by saying, well, you have a King James Bible, and it supposedly is telling the story of what the Israelites did 1400 BC.
Mm-hmm.
But it's written in English.
Yeah.
Well, obviously it's fake. You know,
okay.
No, it's
yeah,
not
right.
Fake. It's a translation,
mm-hmm.
You know, so it's at least 1600 AD,
mm-hmm.
If not further.
Right.
And so that's all we can say. But there are several things that deal with the prophecies. And when you understand that there's been translations like that, it's at least somewhere in the neighborhood of 600 BC, something like that.
Okay.
So the name places are right and that. But to see going forward from there, it's interesting because the Ethiopian Coptic Church put it in their canon. And what happened is around 500 AD or 300 to 500, there were five monophysite churches that broke away from the church universal over a silly thing. But the point is that they kind of broke away and did their own thing. We have our 27 books of the New Testament and our 39 of the Old.
Mm-hmm.
Each one of these churches added an extra book or two.
Hmm.
You know, just things like, so the Armenian church kept 3 Corinthians, the Ethiopic church kept Enoch, things like that. I'm glad they did, or we wouldn't have it, you know. And then finally in the 1800s, R.H. Charles was probably the main guy that translated Enoch.
Mm-hmm.
And since then, though, of course, with the Dead Sea Scrolls, we have fragments of the Book of Enoch in Hebrew.
Ah.
And then there's rumored to be a complete copy in Aramaic. And so when you look at the fragments and you compare it to the Ethiopic, it's almost identical.
Huh.
For instance, one of the prophecies is that Israel, you know, would be enslaved in Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
And in the prophecy, Egypt is looked at symbolically as a wolf, you know, vicious animals or other nations. In the Aramaic copy, it is a bear. So things like that. So mm-hmm. some word in Aramaic is bear rather than, but the basic story is the same. I think that's encouraging because just a few things like that are changed. The basic stories are the same.
Hmm. That's fascinating. And I understand that Dr. Randall Price will be leading a team to examine a new or newly discovered cave at Qumran that apparently has something in it. They don't know what yet, but who knows that, but we might find more in the years to come. There may be more fragments or copies of Enoch and other documents that relate to the Bible that we have yet to discover.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing what they have. I'd like to get a hold of the copy of Gad the Seer and Iddo the Seer and all those works and see what they have to say. Other books, there's 13 history books the Old Testament recommends you read.
Mm-hmm.
And out of those 13, Jasher's the only one that I know that still exists.
Hmm.
So I'd like to get my hands on the other things too.
Yeah, fascinating stuff. Ken, where do people follow your ministry and your work?
My website is BibleFacts.org, and we have a YouTube channel, a Facebook channel, and then the website. You can buy the books from the website. They just link to Amazon, so it's perfectly safe. So, and you can drop me a line there through email or Facebook or anything like that.
And you've done a DVD with Gary Stearman recently.
Yes, we sat down and did a 2-hour synopsis of Enoch and talked about some of the newer things that have come out about the Enoch scrolls and about some of the technology for Nephilim creation and things like that.
Hmm.
And the prophecies, of course.
That's one of the things I really like about Gary. He's theologically conservative, but he will embrace and encourage investigation into these out-of-the-box topics and books that, frankly, most churches don't want to touch. So, well, Ken, thank you very much for your work. We appreciate it. And we thank you for watching at the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference. I'm Derek Gilbert. One of the most remarkable pieces of video that I've seen in recent years, well, recent days, has come from our guest who is presenting them here at the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference. He is, well, he's got a unique background. Don't every day run into somebody who was raised as a witch by a family that was a longtime member of the Illuminati. He spends his ministry now, his efforts trying to educate the church on the danger posed by the occult. He's got a couple of new DVDs out, Illuminati, Gods at the Olympic Games, How Close Are We? And There Were Giants in the Earth, and that's the focus of his presentations here this weekend, Giants in the Earth, Parts 1 and 2. Doc Marquis, Doc, welcome. It's good to see you again.
Yeah, how you been?
Well, doing fine. Getting used to living amongst cattle after growing up in the big city. And let me say, I'm much happier being from Chicago than in Chicago. Still a Cubs fan. That's a blood test they do when you're born in the city. But I, you know, but still, living life out in the country and really loving it. Your DVD, you shared with us a video clip from the presentation. It's included in the DVD set for the Giants in the Earth.
Giants in the Earth, yes.
Yeah. What was it that you caught? How did you catch that video?
Well, these were cameras that were in position in this one area where I've been doing a lot of field work. I can't say much beyond that because I don't want people to go out there and
start
looking for things, contaminating the evidence or whatever, or more than likely ending up hurt. Because where I've been doing my field work, it's so far out in the middle of nowhere, you could die and never be found again.
Mm.
Reason... those areas, if we go by my presentations, you see, certain areas out where I've been have ancient stone circles.
Mm.
And if you remember, where there are stone circles that were built by the ancient giants or anyone along that occult line, there's demonic activity.
Well, you know, it's fascinating because Stan Dale was in here just a bit ago, and Stan is talking about that in connection with the pre-flood world and the links to the giants. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting how, as we talk, we keep finding little points of synchronicity between different presenters here at the conference this weekend, and it's not like we got together and said, okay, you're going to talk about that aspect of the stone circles, and I'll bring in this information. No, it's just, you know, like God had a plan for all of this. But
well, more
anyway.
Than likely, because as I was saying, when we was out there examining all these things, the stone circles and other things, the cameras caught what I've been warning people about for 25 years now. That where you find these ancient megalithic stone circles, you're going to find demonic activity. And obviously that includes manifestation.
Mm-hmm.
And on the footage, which you saw yourself with
right.
your wife, Sharon,
right.
you saw for the very first time that's ever been recorded on film, two genuine demonic manifestations. And when Sharon took a look at it, let's face it, she jumped back almost a foot.
She did. She's working on a series of novels right now.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's
supernatural right. novels, essentially taking the Jack the Ripper murders as a jumping off point, but looking mm-hmm. at that as though it was a demonic series of murders. Mm-hmm. But she had been writing about manifestations of a type, and in her research, she had come up with this concept of these two-dimensional shadow type.
She used the correct term. This is what was interesting. Not only did she say demonic manifestation,
right.
but she also said shadow man. Remember?
Right, right.
And that's what the occult in the Illuminati to this very day calls that first demon you and her saw in the film. That is properly known to this very day as a shadow man.
Now, almost 10 years ago, I interviewed an author who lives in Northwest Missouri, a journalist by trade, but he has a fascination with paranormal.
Mm-hmm.
And he wrote a book called Shadow People about the experience that people will have of seeing what appears to be just a black outline, sometimes often with a hat.
That's exactly right. That's how it usually begins. Now, this is usually the first demon. A child who's usually dedicated to Lucifer at the age of 3, usually that will be the first demon assigned to that child, a shadow man. You described him to the letter. Dark outline, possibly cloak figure, large black rimmed hat or something like that, maybe
right.
like a fedora, you know.
Right.
That's a shadow man.
Right.
That's what they normally look like in the third dimension.
Now, you know, I never really talk about this because I can't verify, can't swear, or well, not that I swear anyway, because, you know, but I would not, still, you know, 30 years later, I don't really know how to process this, but early in my radio broadcast career, I was working all night shift at a station in Peoria, Illinois, and was a little sleep deprived, but I had an episode of sleep paralysis, and was almost
at the station when you were doing the show?
No, yes, not at the station. This was when I was at home. I was trying
okay.
to sleep during the day because I was working the all-night shift, and I remember being awakened and not able to move, but seeing out of the corner of my eye a shadow either on the wall or in the hall. It's not a clear memory, but I do clearly remember this silhouette of something wearing a hat and just being convinced that whatever this was meant to kill me or hurt me in some way, and just terrified.
Was there like a sense of foreboding of evil, something like that?
Absolutely.
Well, yeah.
But
at
that point in my life, I had no understanding of what sleep paralysis was or what this type of manifestation was until much later. And in fact, talking with this author, his name is Jason Offutt, by the way, and then reading more about shadow people and these apparitions, if you will, or manifestations. Now, that only happened to me one time. So, again, as far as I know, I think it was real. I believe it happened, but I wouldn't sign an affidavit in a court of law.
There's only
but,
two possible answers to something like this. Now, I've heard, and I'm sure you've heard, of sleep paralysis and people seeing the shadow man.
Mm-hmm.
A number of times over the years, and it seems to be growing now.
Yeah.
I have been expecting this type of activity and more demonic activity for quite a while now.
Mm-hmm.
That's because when we go to the Book of Revelation, chapter 18, 23, verse B. It tells us conclusively that the entire world is going to be handed over to the Antichrist through the occult. All of it. It didn't say some nations. It said all nations. And we know at the same time that during that the second half of the tribulation period, that the keys to the bottomless pit will be used to unlock
right.
The doors or whatever it is that's keeping the chained demons behind.
Mm-hmm.
So, for this to happen, we have to see an escalation now where it builds with more demonic activity to where it reaches this final outrageous height during the tribulation period. We see the effect, but we've got to look back here for the cause and see how it's going to grow and grow exponentially. This is what's going on right mm-hmm. now. And that's why I'm convinced those demons were caught on film.
Mm-hmm.
Because not too long ago, I mean, it was shortly before we left for the Rocky Mountain prophecy conference right here, I've been given, let's just say, some information right now. And if the information is as I've been told, the situation is really escalating so high right now where I've been that I'm seriously going to limit who comes with me, because I don't want to be dramatic here, but this is going to be a very dangerous situation, and it's three or four. We've got areas we've got to examine, and it's really bad news out there, Derek.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's the proof of what I've been trying to warn people about when it comes to the demonic world and how, literally speaking, shall we say, we're going to be invaded.
There is more that you describe with these demons, and we'll just point viewers to those presentations on the DVD set, because Doc goes through it in detail in his presentation. What is the field work that you're doing? What motivated you to do this field work that led to capturing these on video?
When I was about 10 or 11 in the Illuminati, you know, and I was going through the ranks, you see, at the time, I was a seventh generation witch. See, my family goes back in the order of the Illuminati all the way back to 1789. And so you pick up a lot of things outside of, shall we say, your mainstream teachings in the Illuminati.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the fascinating things when I was in the Illuminati and I was being taught all these things was I heard the stories of these ancient red-haired giants that stood about 15 feet in height, somewhere around there,
mm-hmm.
that literally rampaged throughout the Americas. They were so big, so strong, that literally they could run, pick up a buffalo in between their arms, and just run off. And they would also pick up, you know, like sheep, whatever, cattle, horses maybe, whatever. And they would do this with impunity. And the Native American Indians back, you know, 1,000 years ago or so, couldn't stop them. How do you stop a rampaging horde of giants that stand that tall? One tribe couldn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
But that was the rub of it. You see, someone finally said, well, one tribe can't, but what if we band together? So instead of being on the defensive, they took the offensive and hunted
mm-hmm.
the giants down to extinction. Now, according to the stories that I learned in the Illuminati, the giants, the remnants, I think it was about 10 or 12, the red-haired ones,
mm-hmm.
were cornered in a cave, and they would not come out. And the Indians were throwing in spears, shooting in arrows, whatever they could, throwing in rocks to try to get them out. They refused, so they lit a huge fire in front of the cave to try to smoke them out. Rather than come out, the giants suffocated and died.
Mm.
Now, that means, you see, you have to understand the belief system here, the cultural ones. They would never have touched those bodies. That's a cursed area now. They would have never touched it again. Which means somewhere there's a cave in that area where there is the physical skeletal remains, maybe with hair,
mm-hmm.
of 10 to 12 giants, 15 feet, maybe taller.
Mm-hmm.
Could you imagine if we could find that cave, it would prove the Bible was right all along.
Mm.
If the scientists and the so-called academians and everyone else, they couldn't say, well, that's just one bone, or that's just this one skull. This could be an aberration. No, no, no. If we have 10, 12 full-scaled bodies, look at the skeletal structures. I know the medicine. Folks, you can't argue the evidence. And this is what the Bible said all along.
Mm-hmm. That's what you're working on.
Yeah.
Mm. Doc Marquis' two presentations, There Were Giants on the Earth, Parts 1 and 2, here at the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference. Doc, where do people follow your work on the web?
Oh, easy. Just go to, you know, just put in the usual www dot whatever, and put in It's a God Thing Productions, 777.com. You can find my website that way. Or just use my name as a word search. You can find find me on YouTube. And we're putting up now, because of my brilliant computer doctor, a YouTube channel.
Ah.
We just got the 1,000 subscribers needed, mm-hmm. you know, that they said we need to have. They're filling out the paperwork, and Lord willing, when I get back home, it's a go.
All right. Well, Doc Marquis, here at the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference in Colorado Springs, I'm Derek Gilbert.
You'll find links in the show notes to their websites. The show notes, of course, at vftb.net, or if you're watching this on YouTube, youtube.com/Derek Gilbert. We are putting video versions of these interviews online at YouTube, even the interviews conducted without the benefit of video. If you want to see the video versions of those interviews, by the way, the ones recorded at the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference, you'll have to check out the DVD set being made available in October. That is the target date for release of the DVD sets from the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference. They'll be available both through Prophecy Watchers at prophecywatchers.com and, of course, Skywatch TV at skywatchtv.com. And I can tell you that the deal that Tom Horn is offering is another one of those. The running joke with us at Skywatch TV is that if you buy a book, you get an RV. It's not quite that ridiculous, but that kind of conveys the sense. Tom is offering, with the purchase of the DVD set, the, and I think it's appropriate to mention this, especially just having concluded listening to the Ken Johnson interview, the Researcher's Library of Ancient Texts. That's a 5-volume set. Each of the books is as big as a Metropolitan Telephone book, and it alone, this 5-volume set is worth $149. So, check that out. You'll find that, that special being offered at Skywatch TV, skywatchtvstore.com. The interviews we've got lined up for the next few weeks, I think, are really compelling. And again, we're mixing in video as I can. Most folks these days are familiar with how to use Skype video, so might as well take advantage of it and the powerful computer that we've been gifted. So we're making that available to you. So you can listen at vftb.net. Subscribe to the podcast through iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcatcher, or watch online at youtube.com/Derek Gilbert. And by the way, please subscribe. Thank you. Coming up this Sunday, John Haller, who talks about prophecy and especially looks at news and analyzes geopolitics through a prophetic lens, every Sunday at Fellowship Bible Church, Fellowship Bible Chapel in Columbus, Ohio. And basically, John does on Sunday mornings what I do 4 days a week at Skywatch TV. And it's just that, you know, he's, I think, more perceptive and a better analyst than I am. So we talked for a bit, but the top of the conversation was not really geopolitics. It was about how do we as Christians deal with, interact with other believers who have a different opinion of prophecy. Because we have gotten to a point, and maybe this is, you know, and maybe I'm just noticing it because I'm coming late to the party as far as somebody who has a real interest in Bible prophecy and how it might be fulfilled. This may have been going on for 2,000 years. I don't know. It's possible that the apostles in the first century or the early church fathers in the second and third centuries were, you know, anathematizing one another over their differing views of the Antichrist. But certainly in the 21st century, we Christians have a tendency to do that, in some cases making it a matter of a salvation issue if you disagree with my interpretation of how the end times will play out. Look, the apostles didn't understand the prophecies of Jesus and the Messiah's first coming until after Pentecost. Okay, that was more than 40 days after the resurrection. You can look it up, Acts chapter 1. They were still asking Jesus, 40 days after he was raised from the dead, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel now? They didn't really get it and understand the prophecies from the Old Testament until Pentecost. We probably won't get it any better or sooner concerning the second coming than they did about his first coming. So maybe we should just be a little more gracious with one another. That was the topic that John and I discussed, and you will hear that, God willing, beginning Sunday, August 21st. Next Wednesday, Tom Hughes and New York Times bestselling author Joel Richardson recorded at the Prophecy Conference out in Colorado Springs. And then August 28th, Aaron Judkins, the maverick archaeologist, he is looking for some help. Dr. Randall Price, who was featured here on this program just a week ago, is putting together an expedition for the Qumran Plateau. There's a cave there, recently discovered, that they want to excavate. And there are some exciting aspects of this particular cave that I talked about with Aaron just today, in fact, as I record this. But he needs financial support to cover his expenses, travel expenses, and then lodging and food while he's in Israel. This expedition leaves the U.S. in December, and so he's got a little time yet, but he's needing to raise about $5,000. Now, that's not a huge sum, but it is if it's having to come out of your bank account, okay? So we talk about why another expedition to Qumran. I mean, we've been digging there for 70 years. I thought, turns out that was not quite correct. But anyway, what else could be discovered there? And why an American expedition into an area that is politically sensitive? I didn't really realize this until last week, but Qumran is in the West Bank. That's Palestinian territory, but it's controlled by the Israeli Antiquities Authority. So anyway, that's a conversation you will hear on August 28th. And then August 31st, two more conversations from the Rocky Mountain International Prophecy Conference. Dr. Michael Lake and Paul McGuire, two men always fascinating to listen to. That rounds out the month of August here on A View from the Bunker. Join our Bible study. Sharon and I every week put together a pair of studies, one New Testament, one Old Testament. We're going through the Testaments in chronological order. In the Old Testament, we've just reached the death of David and the ascension of Solomon to the throne. In the New Testament, we're into the book of Acts now, and the very early church. Saul just had his Damascus Road experience. And again, as we go through the Bible in chronological order, you hear the events in the order in which we think they occurred. So those are posted on Sunday morning. We don't do it live. The internet connection out at the ranch, just not quite good enough out there in the country. We're beyond the reach of cable, believe it or not. So we record those and upload those usually by midday Sunday, and it's roughly an hour on each testament. You'll find all of those archives and the reading schedule going forward posted at gilberthouse.org. That's gilberthouse.org. On Skywatch TV for the next few weeks, we're featuring something different. We're talking about music and the ability of music to present a message. Little different kind of music for the Christian realm. Call it gospel blues or blues gospel. We're still figuring that out. It's Joe Horn and Broken for Good. You meet the members of the band, talk about how this project came together, and then in a couple of weeks, we give you the world premiere, as it were, of the video Johnny, which is the lead track from the CD called Right Where You Stand. And of course, that's the message. If you ask, the Lord will meet you right where you stand. That's on Skywatch TV. You'll find it at skywatchtv.com or the Skywatch TV channel on Roku. Give us a review on iTunes, Stitcher, and thank you if you've already done so. I certainly appreciate that. Also, you can discuss the topics we cover here on A View from the Bunker at our Facebook page. You'll find that at facebook.com/viewfromthebunker. A View from the Bunker is a production of Gilbert House and released under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial No Derivatives 4.0 international license. The opening theme is by Kevin MacLeod, www.incompetech.com. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. I'm Derek Gilbert, and this is A View from the Bunker.